There are several parameters that need to be addressed in order to produce good quality olive oil and to conserve its organoleptic properties for a longer period of time. All this will be discussed in detail during this talk. Apart from this, Prof. Mifsud and his team will perform live olive tree pruning so that you can learn better how pruning of olive trees should be done. Allow me to briefly introduce Prof. Mifsud. Prof. Mifsud has distinguished himself for his accomplishments in the biological sciences, particularly in the field of entomology and the preservation of honeybees. He published more than 250 papers in scientific journals, most related to biodiversity studies. He provided detailed information on more than 2,000 living organisms, of which almost 800 species of insects were new records for the Maltese Islands, and he described over 80 new species of insects to science. David Mifsud is also the editor of a peer-reviewed scientific journal entitled Bulletin of the Entomological Society of Malta, devoted to the study of insects in Malta. In the 12 volumes published to date, he managed to get together more than 150 scientists from all over the world to work on Maltese insects. This work generated more than 200 scientific papers, providing information on more than 3,000 species of insects occurring in the Maltese archipelago. Allow me to also briefly introduce Mr. Johan Grima. Mr. Grima has been into olive oil and into olive tree pruning for the last 15 years, taking care of more than 100 olive trees, some of them being very old trees. Apart from the olive trees, he also cultivates around 250 orange and lemon trees, whilst also taking care of the fields around them. Thank you also goes to Dr. Sant Kasia for hosting us. Without further ado, I pass on to our main speaker, Prof. Mifsud, who will introduce his colleagues and start the talk. Welcome, and thank you for accepting to be with us today.
So, people, I'm so happy to have you all here. We thank Dr. Sant Kasia for allowing us to bring all of you over here. So, what will I do in the very beginning is something related to olive oil. Tayeb, at the moment, we are almost at the end of the season. People are pressing their olives to get this excellent olive oil quality. Tayeb. However, there are certain parameters that you need to know in order to have excellent olive oil. Because this is exactly what everyone wants, you know. Everyone in Malta says, oh, this is mine, this is best. Profs, can you come and taste it? And I taste it, okay. I say, good, yes, but, you know, I don't comment further. So, so what are the secrets, you know? There are no secrets, you know. All the secrets that I have learned over these 20 years, I will tell them all to you so that you can know them and you can practice them, you know. First and foremost, everything starts from here, from the field, you know. If you can handpick the olives one by one, it's even better. Why? Because you are not going to damage the fruit, the olive fruit, all right? However, this is very impractical, especially if you have 100 trees, you know, and you need to collect all the olive fruit within 2 days. It's not possible. So you need tools to help you to collect the olive fruit, you know. Doing this, obviously, you're going to create some damage in the fruit. I always tell my students one thing. In order to understand what you're doing, you have to try to enter into the reality of the thing. So if I'm doing a lecture on bees, I always tell, and there are some students of mine here, I can see them, which are doing beekeeping with me right now. I always tell them, listen, enter into the brain of a bee, and then you understand everything. The olive fruit doesn't have a brain, but somehow we have to go there to try to understand it. An apple fruit, all right? You divide it into two. What happens after a couple of minutes? What happens? It starts browning. olives start browning, but we cannot see it, even faster. Even faster. So all the damage that we produce when we are harvesting olives, right here, the damage already present in them, because a percentage of these olives are also damaged, unfortunately, by insects. So there is the olive fly, okay? Shall I tell you the name in Latin of this fly? Because all the organisms on Earth, they have a name, you know? And then I am an urchin, told me, okay, so I won't tell you the name in Latin. So this olive fly, people, is an insect which is waiting for one whole year, waiting for these olives to start maturing. And then once the olive fruits start to mature, they will go, the females, it's always a female, you know, the females will go there and they will oviposit one or two eggs inside this olive fruit, which is almost maturing, you know. And what happens there? There is a small grub making some damage inside the fruit. So again, that's damage. So we have this damage done by this insect, and the damage that we are doing when we are harvesting the olive fruit, okay? Taking this into account, people, taking all this into account, we have to be prepared so that when we collect the olive fruit, ideally in less than 24 hours, these olive fruits are immediately pressed. So I will, a week and a half before I start harvesting my olive fruit, I will start calling the people who actually do the pressing of olives. Listen, when are you available? When can I come? And they will tell, listen, okay, if you come next Monday at 4 a.m., I will do your batch at one go. And then Saturday, Sunday, I get all my people, I'll collect it all. Eh? If I'm going to stay, if I'm going to stay more than 24 hours, people, try to find a cold room. Put a room, you know, in your house with air conditions at 16 and leave it there for 24 hours. And then you take it in the morning. It's even better. Also, you have two possibilities. You can use these crates, you know, which are shallow ones, and there are the ones which are more deep, you know. Don't use those, you know, because the more olives you are gathering into a much deeper box, the more you have this heating up and the more damage is produced. So this is so important, people. This damaging that is going to occur ipso facto, bil force. All right, there is no other. It's impossible. As soon as you remove the olive fruit, even with your hand, the damage will start. All right, so this is something that you have to remember. So the less damage we have, the better is the olive oil. The less olive fly that we have contaminating our fruit, the better is the olive oil. So this is something that you have to remember. The second point is that you have already an appointment with the person who's going to press it for you. All right, so these two things, people, go together. These two things go together. And then you have the oil coming out from the press. And you are so happy, you know. You say, oh my God, you know, from 500 kilos, how much is going to give me? 10%, 9%, 15%, you know, and everyone is calculating. And usually, people, the percentage of olive oil is, I would say, between 11 and a maximum of 18%, you know. This, I mean, so don't go there with 100 kilos and expect 20 liters of olive oil, all right? This is the percentage, more or less, of what's going on. There are certain varieties of olive trees that produce a little bit more. There are certain other varieties that produce less, all right? The olive tree people can be divided into two distinct groups. So there are those olives which are nice, big, etc. And usually those are table olives, you know? So, and as such, those are not really good for olive oil, you know? The olive oil, good quality olive oil comes from olives which are small. So those variety which are small produce a much better olive oil. The organoleptic properties of this type of oil is much, much better than those which are table olives. Okay, so this is something that you have to remember. It's always there. What are we going to do with this olive oil? Once it is pressed, once the people who are pressing it for us, they give it to us. First and foremost, people, don't leave it in plastic containers, because usually they will put it in plastic containers. Don't leave it more than 24 hours in a plastic container. And never leave the olive oil in the light. Don't leave it not even a whole day in the light in a plastic container, because light damages this olive oil. All right, what I'm saying to olive oil people applies a lot also to wine and also to honey. All right, so remember these basic concepts of how this is going to be conserved best. So best are these stainless steel containers. All right, and you have to be extremely careful that it is really sealed. What I do when I seal it, all right, I also seal it again with stretch and seal or parafilm, whatever, all right, so that I'm sure that there is no air being introduced. Another important point that you have to consider is this, people. Don't leave a lot of air inside the container. Inside the container. So if you have 23 liters of olive oil and the container is 20, and you have a container of 50 or 25, put it in the 25. And ideally, the other 2 liters, you can maybe ask a friend of yours, Isma, do you have another 2 liters? Or if not, people, because the more air you have in the container with the olive oil, the more it's going to harm your olive oil. What I do, but obviously not everyone has this possibility, I have a cylinder of argon, which I bought, and what I do is that I replace the air. If I have air, I replace it with argon. Argon is much heavier than air, so I just leave the nozzle there. It will replace the air, and I have a film of argon. Why argon, people? Because this is inert. There is no oxidation. All right, nothing will happen. I seal, and it's done. The temperature, at what temperature should we keep the olive oil? 30, 20, 15, 10 in the fridge. The ideal temperature, people, for olive oil to remain perfect is 14 degrees. 14. 14 degrees. Not in a fridge. 14 degrees is not in a fridge. A fridge is 5 degrees. Okay? Let's say between 14 and 16 is good. All right? So then you have this container of olive oil and you put it in a dark environment. All right? As long as if it's in stainless steel, it's okay. And in these temperatures, people. And you leave it not more than 4 weeks, people. 4 weeks. 4 weeks. And in these 4 weeks, you don't go there and dance with this container. You leave it there and you don't touch it. All right? You don't touch it. If you want to dance, I will tell you where to go, but not there. Okay? After 4 weeks, what happens is that you have some sedimentation. All right, some sedimentation. If you're going to leave this sediment with your olive oil after 4 weeks, the olive oil will be completely destroyed. It will not be completely destroyed, but when I start tasting them, I will feel it immediately. All right, so after 4 weeks you have this sediment and you need to remove it. How are we going to remove it? You have two possibilities. If your olive oil is in a container where the nozzle is slightly higher than the very bottom of the container, then you can just start opening here, filling up your bottles with olive oil and close. All right? And it's no problem. But if this is not the case, you need to, what we say in English, decantation. So if you have a glass here with sediment and water inside it, and we need to remove this sediment, I put slowly in another empty glass, and as soon as the sediment will start to be introduced in this one, I stop. In this manner, generally, you will lose a bit more of your olive oil. But you have to do it, people. You have to do it, because this sediment will kill the excellent olive oil that you have just produced. Okay, so the sedimentation needs to be removed after 4 weeks. And then you fill up all these bottles, or else introduce the olive oil into a new stainless steel container, and you have it, and you have an excellent quality olive oil, extra virgin olive oil. Because what is this extra virgin? This is the level of acidity, and this level of acidity, I mean, I'm trying to be very practical with you, you know, and I'm not going into mathematical formulas, physics, and chemistry. I hate them myself, all right? I'm very practical when I'm trying to explain all these things to my students. So all this extra virgin, etc., is the acidity level. And the more acidic, the less good is the olive oil, you know? And all this is coming from the very first thing that we mentioned, damage. The more damage, the less good is your olive oil. If you leave your olives 3, 4, 5 days, you know, waiting before they are being pressed, how can you have good olive oil with something like that? You have to forget this. So these are, people, these are the very basic principles of how to conserve olive oil for more than 1 year. For more than 1 year, all the organoleptic properties of that olive oil that you have will be conserved perfectly. The more care I give to my trees, all right, the more care I give to my bees, the more care you provide to nature out there, the more nature is going to give you a good product. All right, you can either eat an egg from a hen, which is in a small space like this, it will still produce an egg, and it's good to eat. But you can also eat an egg produced from a chicken, which is free-ranging and eating anything that she finds. It's an egg also, but it's completely different. The taste is completely different, all right? And same with all these people. So our next session is the pruning, the caring of these trees, because the more you keep, the more you're going to love them, the more they will give you. We are going to learn things from each other. I'm always learning, you know. When they gave me this title, this professor title, you know, which I hate so much, you know, I told my colleagues, they give us this title because we should know that so far, we know nothing, and there are so many things that we still need to learn. There are various techniques, people, how you can do something for your table olives, all right? One technique which I use and which I always find very useful is this. As soon as you collect them, these have to be collected ideally by hand, people, because after all, these are olives which are big and you can actually handpick them, all right? As soon as you handpick them, you wash them and you put them in water, all right? And you put them in water, and this water needs to be changed every morning and every evening, all right? Ideally, twice a day. If you don't have this time, once a day, all right? The olives are there in water, and you should keep them there in water for 4 up to 6 days, not more than 6 days, people. Why do we leave them in water? We leave them in water to remove the, we call it in Maltese, mirra, which is a slightly sour taste, that bitter taste that these olives have, all right? That's why. However, people who prefer this bitter taste, they can leave them there for just 3 days, 2 days. All right, for I prefer this bitterness, I don't like it so much. So I usually keep them there between 4 and 6 days. Ideally, inside this water, you have something which helps this process, such as leaves of bay leaves. You can also use leaves of olive tree itself, but using bay leaves there, it's even better. All right, you change this water 6-7 days, and then you introduce these olives into salmoura, which is water and salt. And this depends on you, you know. So you can do it 1:8, 1:10. So if you like a more salty olive, you can introduce more salt. Tayeb, I wouldn't recommend people that after you do this process, the olives, you conserve them under oil. There are certain microorganisms, certain bacteria, which if introduced, they can continue to damage and to practically then you are no longer able to eat these olives. So my advice is to keep your olives in brine, all right, in salmoura. And then when you're going to use them, you can do whatever you like. People can crush them. They introduce garlic with them and some other things. But do it at the last moment. So if you have any questions, I would be more than happy to answer. Yes.
You mentioned the olive fly.
The scientific name of it is Bactrocella olea.
No,
but I was so cheeky about it.
I would like to know on which month does this fly come?
Appear. So it depends on the olive variety that you have, because just after summertime it's already there. So we have done experiments and it's there. It's there. All right. You can so this olive fly, Mela. Let's try to enter into the brain of the olive fly. It's there. Just after summer, probably even July, August, we have collected specimens in the wild. And the olive fruit is still completely solid and the olive fly will not go to deposit an egg on it, but the fly is there waiting. It depends on the variety of the olive tree that you have. Certain varieties mature early. So there are certain varieties that mature in October. There are certain varieties that mature in November. Other varieties in Malta mature even in December. As soon as your olive fruit will start to mature and more soft, this will go and deposit its egg there. What can you do in order to check it? There are what are known as pheromone traps. And you can introduce these pheromone traps in your field. What is a pheromone trap? A pheromone trap is a trap where you have a chemical inside it, and this chemical is going to attract a male. Because all insects, all female insects, from their abdomens, they produce a pheromone. And this pheromone is going to attract the male of my species. So, and we know this, in this case, this chemical, we know it, and we can produce it artificially. So these are pheromone traps, apostalic. And as soon as you find them, you know, you say, listen, it's here, and I'm going to start spraying, for example, against it. And another possibility is that you use a lot of these pheromone traps for what is called mass trapping. So you're going to attract a lot of males, so that there are very few males available to fecund the females. Udal females imsikken jibqaw hemmhekk u ma jkollhom ma jkunux jistgħu jagħmlu tfal għax il-males kollha nqabdu. Tajjeb, so this is a second possibility. The third possibility is this, which is probably the most effective. So the pheromone traps are there so that you know when the fly starts to hover into your fields. It's just an indication for you. The other possibility is this. Let's enter the brain of the female insect. I'm the female insect. I just reproduced with a male. And I have the eggs inside me. The eggs, and what I want is this. This is what I want. I want these eggs to develop as soon as possible. And I go and deposit them. Because I know that my lifetime is very short. I can only survive out there for 6-7 days. So this is fundamental for me. I just need to mature these eggs inside me and lay them. That's all. And then I know that I will die. So, with this mentality, this olive fly needs to eat nutritive food. And this nutritive food is mainly protein. If you want a nice baby inside you, eat a lot of protein. All right? And this is exactly what these flies are looking for. So, people out there, they have developed several chemicals where you have a protein, and inside this protein you have an insecticide. Very often this is called pescare in Italian. Pescare, we have an Italian girl here and an Italian boy. Pescare, so esca, esca, pescare, esca. What is esca in English? It's a bait. La pescare, esca, proteica, protein. So it's a bait made from a protein. And you have the insecticide inside it. And with this chemical, you don't need to spray all your olives, you know. You just need to spray 2 or 3 spots here and there, because these females are going to go directly on it, eat it, and die. So this is what I always try to teach my students. The more you know your enemy, the more you know about your enemy, the more you can use different things to control it. We will never be able to eradicate it. Not even if we do, I don't know what, all over Malta. We're not going to eradicate it, but we can control it. We can use different techniques to control it, so that the populations out there of the solid fly will be reduced. Yellow sticky traps, fantastic, you know. So we have these traps, yellow, and we know that this fly is attracted to the yellow color, and they go there, and they stick because there is a permanent glue, and we can also remove a lot of individuals in this way. There are certain other insects which are attracted to UV light, so we can actually put a UV light trapper during the night, and you can control it like that. So the more we know our enemy, the more we can do something in order to reduce its population density. Okay? Tayyip, responded. Tayyip?
I know that there are sort of 2 ways of thinking of how much water you should give the olive. Some people say water it from young, and some say the minimum possible, so that once established, it's a Mediterranean plant, it won't need any water. Apart from these 2 different ideas, is there an impact on the quality of the olive, whether you water from young or whether you try to give it the minimum and allow it to establish? Will you get a better quality with one way or another?
What a difficult question.
Sorry.
I can speak for an entire hour on this, but I cannot. Water is important for olive trees when they are young, so that they establish themselves, especially in the new terrain. So water is important. Having said this, the olive tree is a tree which is adapted for dry conditions. All right, I can explain its structure and etc. This evapotranspiration that olive trees do is so minimal. So with a little amount of water, they can survive. They won't die like other trees. But if you help it with water, this will... And believe me, helping them with water won't reduce the quality of the olive oil from your olive fruit. Tayyip, in a nutshell, I can do a lecture of 2 hours on this subject, but I cannot because I have a boss here. So you can see sometimes that you have these olives and the leaves are eaten from the outer edges, all right? This is a weevil. Its name is, what is she? Ophiorhynchus moriger. So this is a weevil, and it's a nocturnal weevil.
So I have it on Terra Weaver. It will only go on the trees between 11 p.m. and 4 a.m. All right? Yeah, during that time. It goes there and it starts eating. So in order to reduce these populations, you either go and spray them during that time, or else you need to put along the main trunk of the tree, this dacron, this omenius anche, suftanach, or whatever. I have so that when this is going up, it will get confused there with all this and it will die. However, people, if you have an olive tree and part of its canopy is hanging with some other canopy, these weevils will find another route because they are very, very intelligent and they will still manage to go there. All right? Jekk ma jidħolx mit-tieqa, jidħol mill-bieb, jew bil-kontra somma. Xikta, tala ħareja. Yes, of course. Yes, the names of insects.
No.
But are you convinced that I'm not an nerd now?
I'll tell you at the end.
Okay. No.
So does the quality of the olive fruit depend on the age of the tree?
The quality of the olive fruit, whether it depends, no. So however, the older the tree, the more capacity of olives it can produce.
In volume,
yes. All right? So don't expect a five-year tree to give you 50 kilos of olives. However, a 150 to 100-year old tree can give you.
All right, we have a couple of Cipressina. The little olive.
Okay.
It's very, very oily. You know, when you squeeze it,
yes.
Are they good for olive oil? Assuming that you have the time to...
Cipressina is good for olive oil. Don't think that just because you are pressing it and there's all this liquid squirting out, it doesn't mean that all that is olive. Right. All right? Okay. Most of it is water.
All right.
When you look at the branches of certain olive trees, you can see these knots, these warts in English. In Maltese, it's on felul, but much larger. And they are woody, all right? This is a bacterial infection. In Latin, it's known as pseudomonas. What is Latin lady? Pseudomonas syringa, all right? There is nothing that we can do to remove it. Once a tree is infected with a bacterium or with a virus, we cannot do anything to remove it. Very important, people. So once you have a bacterium in a tree or a virus, there's nothing to do. If you have a plant, a tomato plant with a virus, the farmer will simply go, uproot it, and burn it. Otherwise, all the other tomatoes will get the virus. Can we do the same with olive trees? No. We cannot, come on. I mean, if we have a 100-year-old olive tree with these knots, you know, what will the farmer say? Shall I remove it? No, you can't remove it. I think not even the law allows you to do it, except for another disease that is only present in Italy. All right? But what can I do as a farmer to assist, to help my tree? So what you can do is this. That all these branches having these knots, it's known as olive knot disease, okay? You try to prune them during winter time, during December, January. You prune them carefully, all right? You use all the things that you're going to cut, you put them in a tank, you burn them immediately. All the utensils that you have used need to be sterile. Otherwise, if you use them again on a tree without the bacterium, you're going to introduce the bacterium yourself, all right? And in this way, when all these knots, what do they contain? They are simply full with the bacterium. So when you remove a lot of these knots, all right, you're helping the tree. At that point in time, when you remove most of them, during the pruning season, you need to spray the plant with something which contains aluminium. This is going to help a lot. All right, there are certain sprays which contain aluminium. And this will help a lot. And then you need to help the plant, even if it's an old tree, with fertilizers, so that the amount and quality of olive fruit that is going to produce will be still okay. Tayebek?
Certification, what suggestion?
No, certification, I can stay here for a whole week, it's impossible. So, certification, people, you have different certifications of olives, all right? Certifications, here will be the last question. So, certifications, you need to look, when you buy an olive tree, you should have these phytosanitary certificates. The more you have information, the better. But the more information you have on these certificates, the more you're going to pay. So it's free from viruses, it's free from this, it's free from this, it's free from this. All right? So look for these certifications. It's very important. In Italy, there are diseases which are not present in Malta. Xylella fastidiosa. It's another bacterium that is present in Italy and France. If we introduce this here, it's the end of the olive industry in Malta. So don't do this, people. All right? Don't do this. Whatever you buy, make sure that you have this very important principle of certification. Qabel ma nikkonkludi nintroduċi tliet min-nies. Jistgħu jiġu ħdejja please erba' min-nies. Għandi lil Fredu, Johan, Lorenzo, Ulino. These four people are very important people because they take care of this entire land. Without them, this land will not exist. So I think we should give them a big applause. Johan, Joe Shiberas is also a student at university with me. And Ivan, I forgot your name, Magro, also a student at university doing a diploma in agriculture, a degree actually in agriculture. They will help me today for the pruning session. For the pruning session, we're going to divide into two groups, people. All right, we have two nice trees, and I will take one of you three, and the other two together. We'll divide ourselves, and we will explain everything to you, what we are doing, all right?
Għal-jom, dak jissa joħol bol bal. Għaxti l-għadri. Jina meta is-siġar iġibu għom zog bis, eni siġra din, meta ġiba zog bis, qed tagħmel ħafna ħsara. Dawk il-pajpijiet li qegħdin itellgħu l-ilma mill-qiegħ, huma pajpijiet mejtin, dawk huma mejtin. Alright? Mhux bħal pajpijiet l-oħra illi bl-Ingliż jissejħu flowem. Il-pajpijiet l-oħra flowem. Li huma l-pajpijiet li qegħdin iġorru l-ikel fis-siġra. L-ikel minn fejn ġej. Is-siġra ħadra, għaliex hija ħadra s-siġra. Għax fiha tip ta' klorofilla. Jgħidulha klorofilla. Il-klorofilla permezz tad-dawl tax-xemx tagħmel l-ikel, tagħmel iz-zokkrijiet. U daw iz-zokkrijiet imorru fl-eru, għax qegħdin jikbru l-eru, imorru fil-frott, ecc. Kullimkien, imorru f'dawk il-branches li qegħdin jikbru, ok? Dawk il-vessels tal-flowem huma vessels ħajjin. Il-vessels tal-ġorru l-ilma, mil-ħamrija, għal-weraq, dawk huma vessels mejtin. Issa, hemm dal-proċess li jissejjaħ bl-Ingliż evapotranspiration. Jiġifieri l-ilma minn taħt tiela l-fuq, kemm video sabiħ ta' David Attenborough fejn hu qiegħed fil-hose pipe u da ħireġ l-ilma minnu l-hose pipe u qed jispjegalhom in-nies qed jgħidlhom isma' dis-siġra dal-waraq kollu daqshekk qed jitlef għalkemm mhux qed tarawh l-ilma ħireġ mis-siġra ma daqshekk qed titlef ilma. Issa meta inti siġra taqtala kollox u ma tħallilha l-ebda weraqa, daw il-pajpijiet mejtin li qed itellgħu l-ilma mill-qiegħ mhux qed ittihom possibilità li jkomplu jagħmlu xogħolhom. Għaliex għax m'hemmx weraq, m'hemmx weraq. Allura dil dal-proċess li jissejjaħ bl-Ingliż evaporation, evapotranspiration, ħajjieqaf. U allura ħafna minn dawn il-vessels illi dik is-siġra meta ħallewwa bħal dawk li qataw hemmhekk, ħallewhom zok biss, ħafna minnhom dawk ħajmutu msikken. Dawk ħajerġgħu jirreġeneraw biss meta jibdew l-ewwel free eye buds ġodda. Tajjeb, però ħafna minnhom ħajmutu in the process.